pray God's blessings upon each of you this Holy Thursday. And though we cannot be in this sanctuary together, as a family of God, even though we are separated physically one from the other, we are together spiritually and emotionally. I certainly miss seeing so many of you, and I know many of you are feeling that same yearning to come back together, to worship together, to be in God's house together, to not only love God, but to love on one another. And we pray that the day that we can return is fast approaching. But today, on this Holy Thursday, I wanted to share with you some prayers and some thoughts as we think about that night that Jesus sat with his disciples at the Last Supper, as he washed the disciples' feet. As we think about that evening and all that took place and all that Jesus taught, even in those last moments before his arrest and crucifixion. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we thank you once more. We thank you so much for blessing after blessing after blessing. We thank you for loving us in spite of us. We thank you for walking with us day in and day out. We thank you, Lord, that we can lean on you and trust in you for all things. We lift, Lord, this virus to you, this coronavirus. We lift it to you and pray that you, the great physician, will lay your hand upon it and dissolve it from our midst, that you would rid us of this virus, that you would bring healing, that you would bring a cure, that you would bring comfort to those who are grieving, peace to those who are in chaos. That, Lord, you would fill those who are in fear with an understanding that they need not be afraid, for you are real and you are good and you are with them. We pray for our church family, for Northeast United Methodist Church. We pray that you will keep each one of us healthy and watch over our families, our children. Bring us back together soon. And Lord, we pray that you will speak to our hearts today through your word, through all that is said and all that is lifted up, that we might grow in our relationship with you. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, my rock and my redeemer. You, Lord, not me. You, Lord, not me. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I want to encourage you to try something this evening. One of the things that many churches do on Holy Thursday is a foot washing ceremony. Now, I have done this many times in the past. At times, I've had specific groups of people who came up to have their feet washed by me, or would wash each other's feet. Say a small group that had been through disciple Bible study together. Other times I invited people from the congregation to come forward. Anyone that has had this done or has done this to someone else, had their feet washed or washed someone else's feet, they have always said what a powerful moment it is. We remember that Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, including that of Judas, his betrayer. That Jesus taught as he did that, that we are to serve one another, to love one another. not to lord it over one another, but to be humble. And Jesus, by example, got down on his knees and took a towel and washed the feet of his disciples. So I want to encourage you to try this. Perhaps before the message, perhaps at another time. So I invite you to get a basin or bowl, a towel, fill it with warm water, and gather the family together. Gather whoever is there at home with you together. Now I want to share with you a litany of foot washing. And so hopefully you have that basin of warm water and a towel. Family is there together. Pray with me. Loving God, as Jesus took a basin and poured the water long ago, we bring these basins of water before you. Bless this water for washing, and bless the feet of your servants too. Wash away the stains and the strains of this life, we pray, that we may walk anew in the ways of Christ. In true humility, we bend our lives in service to you. Help us all by your example to grow in understanding how we are meant to serve rather than be served. For love's sake, in Christ we pray. God of tenderness and compassion, on the night before he died, Jesus set a table for his disciples, those who would soon deny, betray, and scatter. All gathered together, they took off their sandals and sat down in the presence of their teacher and Lord, who washed their feet one by one. We pray for people whose feet are tired and dusty from hard labor, for those whose backs are bent by care and worry, those laid low by illness or guilt or grief. Wash away, we pray, the tiredness of our bodies and souls. Hold gently in your healing hands the broken places in our lives and relationships. Be our company in isolation, our source of hope and despair, and the way forward at every dead end. God of all good gifts, thank you for setting a table of welcome for everyone, for making room whether we are faithful or faithless or failures. We pray that all who are hungry will find enough to drink and enough to eat as we share and live more responsibly. Teach us to sit down with enemies, sharing common meals and common hopes. Make us true servants of yours for the sake of the world. Teach us to love as you love for the sake of the world. In Christ's name we pray. And now I invite you, as I've shared that liturgy from the book Feasting on the Word, liturgy for foot washing, I invite you to wash the feet of your family, of your children, your spouse, of one another. And if you are home alone and you don't have anyone there at this moment because of the quarantine, the virus, place your feet in the bowl or the basin of warm water and pray and ask God to wash your feet. Like Peter, cry out for God to wash all of you, to cleanse you, to make you clean. Give God thanks for his love and his blessing. Thank God for cleansing you through his Son, Jesus Christ. Spend time with God in prayer. As we continue this time of Holy Thursday, I want to share with you a message that I've entitled, He Loved Them to the End. I want you to try to picture the scene, and many of you have seen Da Vinci's Last Supper. Of course, the most famous picture of that night, that Holy Thursday, when Jesus shared the Passover meal with his disciples. And there have been many famous paintings done of Jesus washing the disciples' feet, showing them how to love one another. The scripture we're going to look at today begins a little bit after Jesus washes the disciples' feet. The first two verses are before that. They're right off the bat in John chapter 13, verses 1 through 2. But then we're going to skip down past the foot washing to John 13, verses 20 to 32. John 13, verses 1 to 2. It was just before the Passover festival, and Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own, who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. And now we skip down to verse 20. Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me." And after he said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, "Very truly I tell you, one of you is going to betray me." His disciples stared at one another at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, "Ask him which one he means." Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish." Then dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. And as soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered him. So Jesus told him, What you are about to do, do it quickly. But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had change of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the festival or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out. And it was night. And when he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. And if God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once." Now, there's a very famous painting of Jesus and the disciples and Judas Iscariot turned away, walking off, going to betray Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. But what I want to really focus on in tonight's scripture, this Holy Thursday, is actually up in verses 1 to 2 of John 13. Having loved his own who were in the world, Jesus loved them to the end. Having loved his own who were in the world, Jesus loved them to the end. So let's look at the first part of that verse. Having loved his own who were in the world. His own. See, we belong to Christ when we accept Christ, when we accept that invitation, when we have a relationship. We belong to Christ. We belong to Christ in a threefold way. One, we belong to Christ by the Father's adoption. The Father's adoption. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. Paul writes, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will. To the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he has lavished on us." We have been loved by God before the creation of the world. And we've been given the privilege and the opportunity to accept and embrace that love. To be God's adopted children through God's gift of his Son. Whoever so believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. As God's adopted children, we belong to Christ. We are brothers and sisters to Christ. Romans 8:29 tells us, "For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that his Son, Jesus, might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters." So we belong to Christ in a threefold way. The first way is by the Father's adoption. The second way is we are Christ by his redemptive rights. He paid the purchase price. He bought us for himself through his sacrifice on the cross. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 7 to 8, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us." And then later in chapter 2, verse 13 of Ephesians, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ." And Romans 5:9, "Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him?" Christ shed his blood for us, gave himself up for us. And so we, in turn, having accepted that gift, that sacrifice, accepted that relationship that Jesus offers, we belong to Christ. And the third way we belong to Christ is we are his by the call and indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Again, remember, we're coming out of that verse in John 13, "Having loved his own," Jesus saying, having loved his own, we are his own. We belong to Christ when we accept that relationship because of the love the Father has lavished on us, because of the blood that has been spilt to redeem us, and because of the call and indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, 14 to 17. "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory." We are created anew by the third person of the Trinity, born of the Spirit. 2 Corinthians 5:17. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here." 1 Corinthians 6:19. "Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own." You belong. When we accept that relationship and we invite Christ into our hearts, we belong to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Having loved his own, who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And so let's look for a moment at the second part of that verse. He loved them till the end. Think about that. He loved them till the end. Till the end. Till the end of this earthly pilgrimage. Till the end. Through the wilderness that we travel. Till the end, till we see him face to face and know as we are known. I want you to think for a moment about the other part of the scripture we read at the beginning from John 13 that talked about Judas. Now Jesus tells his disciples that someone at the table is going to betray him. But the disciples don't understand. They can't comprehend one of them betraying Jesus. And in fact, several of them ask, "Is it I, Lord? Is it I?" Because they understand not one is righteous, not one. They understand that wickedness can lurk within. It can go unseen and it can go hidden in any of us. Perhaps they are going to be the one to betray Jesus. Is it I, Lord? Simon Peter, he wants to know, and so he nudges the disciple that most believe is John, the author of the gospel, who is sitting next to Jesus on his left. And Simon Peter says, ask him which one he means, which one is going to betray him. So John does ask Jesus, and Jesus answers, it is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. And then he gives that piece of bread to Judas. But they still don't grasp it. I mean, Jesus is giving Judas this piece of bread dipped in the cup, which was a supreme act of hospitality, a supreme act of love. And many theologians believe because it seems from the reading of the Gospels that Judas was close enough for Jesus to speak with and to give this piece of bread to, that Judas may have been sitting at his right, which was a place of honor, a place of love, that Jesus was still reaching out to Judas, showing him love. And we know before all this took place, Jesus washed the feet of the disciples, including Judas, who he knew would betray him. So the disciples still can't grasp that one of them will betray Jesus. They can't grasp that Judas would betray Jesus. Judas is their friend. Judas has traveled with them for years. He's just a normal guy. Now, a lot of times, those who betray us, they don't look evil. They don't act evil. They don't seem like demons. Often they look like you and me. So what's interesting here is if you can imagine the Last Supper. Now at this point in history, tables, they did not sit at chairs. So this is a very low table, and they would sit on pillows on the floor. And they would kind of lean on their left arm. So they would be sitting kind of sideways a little bit with their feet facing out from the table on their left arm so they could use their right hand to eat. And so if you could picture that around the table, it means that each disciple, their head was somewhat in almost the lap of the person next to them. And so John is right there, connecting to Jesus, close to Jesus, the disciple whom Jesus loved, resting in the lap of Jesus, figuratively. Now on the other side is Judas, which would mean that Jesus' head was toward Judas. And I think about that, and I can picture Jesus leaning toward Judas and yearning for Judas not to go through with the betrayal, to repent, to accept, to love Jesus, to accept the love that Jesus has for him. And perhaps there were other ways that Jesus could have been brought to the cross. Perhaps there are other ways he could have fulfilled his mission. without Judas making the choice that he made. So here at the table, on one side of Jesus, you have John, who loves Jesus and walks with him. And on the other side, you have Judas, who betrays him. And in the middle, you have Jesus, who, it says, he loved them till the end. He loved all of them. All of them. On both sides. You know, I had to think about the question, which one are we? John or Judas? Which side of Jesus are we sitting? Are we sitting on a side trying to hide our sin, trying to hide our betrayal of others, our betrayal of our best selves, our betrayal of God's word and direction? Or are we curling up on the lap of Jesus, seeking forgiveness for the things we have done, admitting our demons, and resting in the relationship that Jesus offers? That is the type of question that we're meant to think about during Holy Week. But the thing I truly want you to grasp tonight is he loved them to the end. He loved them to the end. A.W. Pink, P-I-N-K, who lived from 1886 to 1952. He was an English Bible teacher, and he was little known during his lifetime, but became one of the most influential evangelical authors in the second half of the 20th century. And he writes about this passage in his commentary on the Gospel of John. He loved them to the end. This is what A.W. Pink says. Listen to this. He loved them unto the end. Not only until the last, but to the farthest extent of their need and of his grace. He knew that Philip would misunderstand him, that three of them would sleep while he prayed and agonized, that Peter would deny him, that Thomas would doubt him, that all would forsake him. Yet he loved them to the end. And so it is with us, dear Christian reader. His own are the objects of his love. Unto the end is the extent of his love. He loves us unto the end of our miserable failures, unto the end of our wanderings and backsliding, unto the end of our unworthiness, unto the end of our deep need. His love, no end or measure knows. No change can turn its course. Eternally the same it flows from one eternal source. The cross was before. Jesus, with all its horrors and the joy of returning to the Father, was before him with all its bliss. Yet neither the fearful prospect of woe, nor the hope of unspeakable rest and gladness, shook his love for his own. He is the same yesterday and today and forever. He loved us with an everlasting love. He is divine, and therefore is his love different from all others, passing human knowledge. And even with the horrors of the cross before him, even with the bliss of knowing he was returning to his Father before him, he still focused on those there. He loved them to the end. In a moment, as we close our time together for this Holy Thursday, I'm going to offer up a prayer of confession. I pray that you'll take time to sit with God tonight, tomorrow. Ask God to show you those areas of your life that aren't quite where they need to be. Perhaps attitudes that aren't quite what they need to be. Priorities that aren't quite what they need to be. That whatever it is he lays on your heart, that you confess and you seek God's forgiveness. And you know that no matter what you've done, no matter what you've done 30, 40 years ago or yesterday, or just 5 minutes before turning on this video, whatever you've done, God will love you to the end. Jesus will love you to the end. He loves you so much he went to the cross and gave up his life and spilt his blood for you. Jesus will love you to the end. And through his sacrifice, you can have forgiveness and hope. You can be a new creation, an adopted son or daughter of God Almighty. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. His love is not going to stop. Whatever it is that you carry with you, confess it up to God in the name of Jesus and accept not only the relationship that Christ offers, but the forgiveness and grace that Christ offers and the Holy Spirit that is ready to come in and live in and through your life. Amen. Amen. So again, I want to share with you from Feasting on the Word, a call to confession and a prayer of confession. Gracious God, our hearts are a battleground between faithfulness and betrayal. We are weak, but he is steadfast, trusting in the unwavering love of Jesus Christ, who has delivered us from slavery to sin and death. Let us confess our sin. Lord Jesus Christ, how well you know our hearts, and you still love us. You have loved us to the end. We have denied you and we have denied our calling to serve one another. We have betrayed you and we have betrayed your commandment to love one another. Pour out your spirit of grace upon us. Teach us to love and serve faithfully and to love and serve one another by the example you have set for us. In your holy name, we pray. Lord, as we take time tonight, tomorrow, lay things on our hearts that we need to share with you. Help us to confess all the things we have done or failed to do, all the hurts we have caused, all the impure thoughts we have had. Help us to confess all to you. And in these prayers we offer you this Holy Week, hear our prayers and lead us to your grace and forgiveness. We ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And know, if you open your heart to God these days, if you lift up whatever you find in your self-examination, seek forgiveness. Know that the Lord Jesus Christ has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him, and the promise is fulfilled, and love's redeeming work is done. And in Jesus Christ, you are, we are, forgiven. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. I pray that you continue to experience God's peace and blessings during this time, this difficult time. And I pray most of all that you will never forget, never forget how loved you are. And if you have opened your heart to Christ, you belong to him, and he lives and cares and watches over you. In such a time as this, and in all times, praise be to God. God bless. Take care.
Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit.